a loser. I mean, he, you know, had been a fireman and quit that job, been a policeman and quit that job, been a member of the Board of Supervisors, quit that job. White didn't care. He didn't really have any particular beliefs in anything important politically.
He had to be the warrior out there on Shawnee Street or wherever the hell they were from, you know, protecting all this. But he had a sense of entitlement. I'm straight. I'm white. I'm Catholic. I'm a fireman. I'm a policeman. I was a Green Beret. I am who it should be.
People liked Dan White. I mean, he was a nice kid. He was a kind of all-American guy to a lot of people. I think they saw a lot in Dan that they really admired and that they really would have liked their own kids to become. The notion that this all-American guy, solid citizen, nice wife, little kid, could go out and cold-bloodedly shoot two people was not something people wanted to accept. An edge to it. I mean, let's remember that. Dan had an edge to it.
And tell me what the mayor says.
Okay. Maybe we can meet Mary Ann and have some lunch.
Okay.
Here. I heard that you're not gonna give it back to me. My job. Is that true?
You in the fucking mouth. How could you be so stupid? How?
I want to tell you, Frank. I want to explain.
Turn on the tape. I'm aware of your past history as a police officer, so I'll let you do this in narrative form. If you lead up to the shooting, then backtrack as to why these events took place.
The facts are, it was he, Dan White, who brought the gun to City Hall. And it was he who brought the extra cartridges. And instead of going through the metal detector, he decided to go around the corner where he climbed in through a window to City Hall. Now, what do you call that but premeditation and deliberation? What do you call that realistically but a cold-blooded killing? Two cold-blooded executions. It occurs to me that if you don't call them that, you're ignoring the objective evidence and the objective facts here. Members of the jury, there are circumstances here which no doubt bring about anger, maybe even rage. But Dan White reloaded after shooting the mayor. If it was reflex police training, why didn't he reload again after shooting Harvey Milk? And what explains the coup de grace shots that Dan White fired into the backs of their heads as they lay there helpless on the floor? Ladies and gentlemen, The evidence before you here screams for a verdict of murder in the first degree.
It's just that I've been under an awful lot of pressure lately. Financial pressure because of my job situation, and family pressure because of not being able to see my family. I was troubled, and the pressure.
I am not asking you to forgive Dan White. He is guilty. But it is the degree of responsibility that is the issue here. Lord God. The pressures. That he's got to be punished, and he will be punished. He's going to have to live with this, and his child will live with it, and his family will live with this, and God will punish him, and the law will punish him. Please. Please. Justice. That's all. Just justice here.
You have all seen the violence that springs from oppression. You have seen the blood of George Mastrone and Harvey Milk on the floor of city government. And whose hand was it that spilled their blood? Whose hand was it that pulled the trigger? It was Dan White who pulled the trigger. It was Dan White, baby. Dan White pulled the trigger. Dan White.
Out to a babysitter. My wife's gotta work 50 and 60 hours. Never see my family.
When you left home this morning, Dan, was it your intention to confront the mayor, Supervisor Milk, or anyone else with that gun?
No. I just wanted to talk to him. I didn't know if I was gonna be reappointed or not reappointed. Why do we do things, you know?
In the early 70s, San Francisco was undergoing a rather radical transformation. In the late 70s and the early 70s, it began to open up to the world. It was no longer a kind of closed society. The revolutions of the 60s had brought demands of the blacks, of the Latinos, into the political scene. A commission on the status of women had been established, and the city was undergoing kind of a mass migration of gays.
Let's call it a day, okay?
How you doing?
It's fine, thanks.
You use another player?
Sorry, it's law enforcement only. It's cops to you.
I am a cop. Northern Station.
What's your name?
Dan White.
Frank Falzone.
You don't remember me, do you? I was one of the no-names who used to shag fly balls for you over at Reardon High.
Huh. Cop now, huh?
My dad was a fireman. It's Charlie White.
Well, we could sure use you on the team.
Great.
You had a great arm.
Thanks. What the problem is, half these people don't even speak English. They bring in their own culture, they isolate, they don't even try to fit in. You're looking at what I think we're looking at?
Yeah, the boa.
I guess. Which one's the girl? bust him? Can we cite him for anything?
It's fucking unnatural.
Hey!
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 Sit down right there. Don't move. I'll be back in a minute.
Well, well, well. Look what the cat dragged in. Remember me? What'd you do this time? Huh? Rob an old woman?
Fuck you.
Huh? Roll some poor old drunk? What? You fucking bastard. You want me? I'll tell you what. Come on, you sack of shit. Just you and me right here, right now. Come on, what are you waiting for? A new hairpiece? Come on, get the fuck up. Shit. Huh? I got this so for you. Oh!
Ah! Well, Connor, you're not
fucking hit.
Go, what the hell are you doing? Hey! You stop it right now. Or I'll write you up. That's my collar.
He's running his fucking belt at me, and I'll write you up. Fuck you, you will.
You think I won't?
Huh?
This rap sheet reads like a book. You and a tag with Connor.
He went nuts. He would have killed the guy. You had to be there.
You're not going to blow the whistle on a fellow cop. We just don't do that.
It wasn't right.
Are you the chief here, Dan? You're the mayor. You a banker with a mansion in the Heights? We work for all of them.
We have to grind a few worthless bones into dust from time to time to keep this city running. Well, I'm proud to do it. It's part of the job. Now tear this up.
No. I can't do that.
You're one of us, Dan. I hope you know. You always will be.
Why'd you quit this time?
I just didn't feel like I was helping anybody.
Doesn't matter now, Ma. You heard, huh? How's the family?
If you'd come by, you'd see.
I'll come by.
Well, so what'll it be now, son? Sitting here the way you do? There's nothing on the walls? Have you forgotten your faith?
I like it. It's fine.
It isn't right. Don't you think that you should see someone? Or a professional?
You don't think I can handle it, Ma? I can. Thank you very much.
Something to drink, Ma?
Where's the cop? Now a fireman. What's next, Dan? Post office?
I'll see you guys later.
No.
Yeah, see you, Charlie.
No, Frank. Just wasn't me. Just want to turn over a new page, do what I like.
You know what you need?
What's that?
I'm going to introduce you to someone.
Who?
You'll see, someone special.
No. Frank, I'm not going out with your sister.
You wish, bud.
No.
Frank, this feels like a stakeout.
You meet this girl you're gonna marry. Trust me, I know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Nice to see you too. This is my friend Dan White. Dan
Hi.
White, Marianne Burns.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Dan's with the fire department. First in his class.
Really? My dad was a fireman.
You're kidding me.
No.
Really? Where's he stationed?
Mission?
I'm at Potrero.
No kidding.
Yeah, my dad was a fireman too. And I could see the game they were playing. They wanted to use me as a scapegoat. And they had a political opportunity. They wanted to denigrate me and my family and the job that I was trying to do, and more or less, just hang me out to dry.
You went directly from your residence to the mayor's office this morning?
Yes, I had my aide pick me up, but, you know, she didn't have any idea that I had a gun on me, or that, you know.
It's your police service revolver, Dan.
Yeah, I keep it down in my room, and I just put it on, you know. I don't know why I put it on, it just... And then, I went to see the mayor, and he said that he wasn't gonna reappoint me. And I got kinda fuzzy. Just, my head wasn't right. I just kinda stumbled into the back room, and he was all smiles, and talking, but none of it was getting through to me, and there was, like, this roaring in my ears, and I just shot him. That was it. It was over. Just shot him. I don't even know if I wanted to kill him. I just shot him.
As gay people, and as people of color, and as women, we all know about the cycle of brutality and ignorance which pervades our culture. And we also know that brutality only begets more brutality, and violence only sows the seed for more violence. Now, when you open your good book, I hope that you remember that. Oh, and remember to vote Harvey Milk, honey.
Can you read this shit, Danny? I'm calling it the Castro now. I can remember what it was called, the Parish of the Most Holy Redeemer.
Oh, come on. Harvey Milk.
Right.
McQueen of Fagulas. Remember him? The guy ran three times and lost. He's recruiting kids now.
Yeah.
Probably get in. Drag queens. Christ, like I'm supposed to smile when I see two men French kissing on the street. Is that why you joined the fire department? To hose down the queers. The adults pee on the hydrants, you know.
Run.
Find that fist fucked to death and they say it ain't murder, it's mutual consent.
And Moscone, Jesus, the mayor hires this faggot-loving chief of police who's not even from this city.
He didn't appoint you, huh?
He tells us to treat the queers with lavender gloves, makes us paint our cop cars faggot blue. So he's gonna pay a full-time fruit, $9,000 a year to be a part-time employee. Who's gonna stop? Who do we have?
Young man, there's no need to feel down. I said, young man, pick yourself off the ground. I said, young man, cause you're in a new town. There's no need to be unhappy. Young man, there's a place you can go. I said, young man,
I am Harvey Miller, and I'm here to recruit you.
And I'll show you the right many ways to
I'm here to recruit you for the right to defend democracy against the John Briggses and the Anita Bryants. And all those who would constitutionalize bigotry, and we are not going to let that happen.
You can get yourself clean.
your poor, your huddled masses yearning to be free. And on the Declaration of Independence, it says all men are created equal, born with certain inalienable rights.
Wasn't very polished at the time, and he was kind of disjointed. But I was a teacher, my friend was a teacher, we recognized potential, and we were just blown away by what he was saying. But I knew right then and there that Harvey had won me over and that a star had been born.
Frank, I'm gonna run for office. Take a swing at city supervisor.
They want to let the politicians do all that.
They all live uptown. They're busy chasing checkbooks on the cocktail circuit. They always have been. You know that.
Yeah.
Guys like us, we know. I mean, do you believe what's going on out there? You know, the one good thing this mayor's done is push through this district election idea. There are 11 districts. Each one gets to choose their own supervisor. You know, there's some gay guy running over in District 5. There's some colored gal running someplace else, some Chinese guy around here. Why not me? It's a step up the ladder, Frank.
Hey, you already have a ladder. You're a fireman.
Yeah, well, so is my dad. What did I get him? A medal. It's time I did something, right? Something good for the city. I'll make it happen. You watch me.
You want to know what makes this place so popular? It's not the poppy seed strudel, although the strudel's not bad. It's people, listening to people, doing what I can for every one of God's kids that comes through this door. District 8, that's what I'm here for.
Go ahead, Golden.
So what are you here for? To get my vote? We're gonna need someone to run Dan's campaign. We hear you know everyone. Run your campaign. You think you can do this, huh?
I'm from this neighborhood. I know people here. My dad was a figure. Sure I can.
You're living here now? In the avenues. There's District 11. You ought to be running there.
Well, don't know anybody there.
The regs say you have to reside where you run.
Then we'll move. We'll buy a house. But, you know, whatever it takes, I will handle it.
Do you know Dan's a hero? He rescued a mother and child from a burning building. I saw one of those flyers someplace.
Yeah, we put those up all over the neighborhood.
I'm glad you're a good fireman, Dan. But that's not going to cut it in politics. You have to stand for something. You have a platform?
Yeah. Sure I do.
What is it?
Well, I've seen the city and how it's changing, and I want to help the people. I want to help the people that live here. You know what I'm talking about.
No. What do you believe in, Dan?
Dan, Goldie's an activist. I'm a campaign manager. Look, Ray, the only reason I went with Goldie is because I didn't think you wanted to work with me, that's all. Well, I'm ready to work with you now. Dan White, hero fireman, saves mother and child. This is the kind of advertising money can't buy.
Ray, you know, Danny gave Goldie his word.
Goldie was wrong. You gotta go with your instincts, Danny. It's your call. Okay, Ray. Goldie's out.
Good.
So what are we gonna do first?
Like this, right? Good, good. Okay.
By choosing to run for supervisor...
Yeah, good.
I've committed myself to the confrontation which can no longer be avoided.
Good, good. Great.
Perfect.
That's great. Like a winner, man.
I wanted to serve the city of San Francisco well, and I think I did that. And then when the pressure got too much, I decided to leave, and after I left, my family and friends came to me, and they said that whatever it took to get me back in office, well, they'd be willing to do that. But there were others who were working against me, and...
from San Francisco by many of our family members. In a deteriorating social structure, they have fled to temporary havens. In a few short years, these malignancies of society will erupt from our cities and engulf the sun-drenched, tree-lined streets of communities that chide us for daring to live in San Francisco.
Thank you, one and all. Thank you, one and all. With this election victory tonight, we send a momentous message to America.
Yet you must realize that there are thousands of angry, frustrated people, such as yourselves, waiting to unleash a fury that can and will eradicate the malignancies that blight our beautiful city.
You can no longer close your eyes and your ears to the gay community.
Yeah! I am not going to be forced out of San Francisco by splinter groups of radicals, social deviants, and incorrigibles. Unite and fight with Dan White.
And thank you, Anita Bryant, wherever you are.
That's all you get.
Danny, this is Denise Apkar. She wants to come work with us.
Hi. Great. Oh, hi, Denise. Yeah. If Ray says it's okay, that's great. We'll see you next week.
Okay.
Mayor.
Thanks. Mayor's here.
Hey, glad to meet you, Dan White. Congratulations. You ran one hell of a campaign.
Thank you. So nice to meet you. This is Ray Sloan, who ran the whole show.
Ray, really pleasure.
And this is my wife, Marianne.
Oh, it's so nice to meet you. You must be so proud.
We all are, Mr. Mayor.
Well, please, George, we're all Democrats here. Dan, it is so good to have you on the team. I'm off to see some more of the winners. Why don't you drop by the house sometime, shoot a few hoops?
That'd be great.
Thanks for stopping by. Really appreciate it. Hey, the mayor!
Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome to the club.
Thanks, Diane.
Dan, nice to see you. Thank you for the flowers. It was a lovely gesture.
Oh, you're very welcome.
Have you met Harvey Milk?
No, hi. Dan White.
Glad to know you.
You ran a heck of a campaign.
Nice to see you this year.
Well, I lost two in a row, but I think I tired him out. You did it right the first time. Congratulations.
Oh, thank you. Well, this district election's really helped me out, I think. And these establishment guys have had their way long enough. I think we're going to give them a run for their money.
I'm in. I bet there's a lot we could probably agree on. Why don't you come by Castro Camera one day? The yak? I'll treat you to a cup of coffee.
Okay, well, I'm real busy, but I'll try to stop by sometime.
Okay.
Nice to meet you.
Take your seats, please. Thank you all, and welcome to a new era in San Francisco government. This is an historic day, a day when all San Franciscans can say that they are truly represented by their elected officials. As president of the board, I pledge to work with all of you, new members and old, toward the goal of creating a city we all can be proud of. Please rise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands.
Chief, group award?
Yeah, sure. What can I do for you?
Don't take this wrong. We're gonna have to let you go.
What?
Danny, it's something with the charter. It says you can't hold two city jobs at the same time.
What? Yeah, but... what about Feinstein, Koch, Silver, some of the others? They've got two jobs. What difference does it make?
They're not city employees.
Look, this job pays more. I need this job.
Want to choose the other?
Jesus! Christ.
Dan White.
How are you doing, Dan?
Yes, sir.
I'm leaving those for your signature.
Oh, great. Thanks a lot. The issue is the city's facing a revenue crunch. Remember Prop 13?
Oh, yeah.
Well, the bottom line is, by the end of the year, we may not have enough money to pay the clerks, the teachers, the firemen, or the police.
Well, that's unacceptable.
Yeah, tell me about it. So what I'm proposing to meet the city's payroll is a real estate transfer tax. Hmm? So, do I have your promise of a vote on that?
That's why I'm here? That's what you called me in about?
The city's payroll? Dan, is there any issue more vital than that one?
Oh, no. 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 I just thought a commissionership was up for grabs or...
Dan, our work, what we do, it's not for personal gain. It's for the city and for the people that keep it going, isn't it?
Sure.
Well, just tell me I've got your vote on this real estate transfer tax.
Sure. As long as the cops and firemen get paid.
Why are we doing this? This should have been just family. How are we going to pay for it? And on top of everything else?
Marianne.
No, I'm going to have to go back. I could go back to work.
No, you don't have to do that.
Well, I don't know how we're going to...
I don't know. But please, I'll handle it. Okay, I'll figure something out. Now, come on.
People have got to be here any minute.
Plus, there's the campaign deficit. City made me quit my job at the fire department.
Thank you.
Marianne hasn't been able to work because, well, you know, pregnancy and all. I'm not complaining, Diane, but it's just not fair.
Well, I want you to hang in there, both of you. Let me talk to a couple people. We'll see.
Hello.
Excuse me. Harvey.
Hi, Dan.
Hey.
Congratulations.
Thanks. I'm so glad you made it.
I want you to meet my friend Scott Smith.
Hello, Scott. This is my wife, Marianne.
Marianne. Harvey Milk.
This little guy right here is a future Hall of Famer, Charlie White.
Oh, Mazel Tov. Let me see this baby. Oh, what a Polaroid. So cute. Look at that diamond. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Marianne.
Oh, thank you.
Hope you can use it.
Sweet. I hope so, too.
We'll get something to drink.
Please, yeah. Help yourself. This youth campus issue, I've been campaigning really hard against it, and I know you're the swing vote. I was wondering if you could help me out.
Oh, God, I promised Scott I wouldn't talk politics tonight, but I think we can work something out.
Great, thank you.
On a quid pro quo, right?
Yeah, what is that?
The gay rights ordinance. Your vote.
Sure. Yeah, okay.
Wonderful.
Okay. Thanks. Hey, who's got a camera? Someone take our picture.
Right here?
Here, come here.
One, two, three.
There was an important issue out in Dan's district concerning the transformation of a convent into a kind of youth home. And sort of an early manifestation of NIMBYism, why a number of the neighbors were opposed to it. And Dan had campaigned that he would fight it in City Hall. When he got to City Hall, he had asked Harvey if Harvey would vote with him. Harvey's story always was that he had looked into the issue and he had decided that he wouldn't. At any rate, when the vote came down, Harvey had voted against Dan. And Dan took that very hard, regarded that not only as a vote against him, but as a lie, as a betrayal. And from that point on, Dan sort of made it a rule to vote against anything that Harvey was in favor of.
It's being branded a predator. It's being told that you don't have the right to be who you've always dreamed of being. Now, I'm a teacher. That's what I've always dreamed of being. And I'm good at it. And I'm not a criminal.
And that's what he'll be if Proposition 6 passes. And we can't let that happen. And we're not talking gay rights here. We're talking life rights. We're talking the life of some kid in Indiana or Idaho who needs to know that he has the right to be who he is. We can't live in fear. That kid can't live in fear. We cannot be afraid of being who we are.
Proposition known as the San Francisco Gay Rights Ordinance has passed with a vote of 10 in favor, 1 against. Everyone take your seat, please.
Madam Chairman, I would like to thank the board for their support of this long overdue legislation. The city sent a powerful message to bigots out there who feel that they have the right to bash gay people and to imprison their very souls in closets of shame. I guess I only regret that our mandate could not have been unanimous.
Great to see you. I'd like to meet my wife, Marianne. Mary, how are you?
Thank you.
It's good to see you. Thank you so much for coming. I appreciate all your work. Hey, Bobby, how you doing?
How are you?
Great to see you. The hat's filling up.
Gonna go over the top tonight.
Great to see you. Thanks so much for coming. Thank you for your support.
Very nice to meet you.
Very
nice to meet you.
Thank you.
Very nice to meet you. I love your dress.
Thank you so much for coming. I appreciate all your work.
Vic Rossi?
Dan White.
Vic, how are you? Great to meet you.
Dan White.
This is my wife, Marianne.
Hi. Nice to meet you.
Such so nice to meet you.
I've heard a lot about you. Riley and Ray here told me so much.
Hey, Dan.
How you doing?
Doing great. Right?
You too.
Very interested in what we're doing.
Okay. Yeah, for so much, I'd love to hear more about your plan.
And, at least you will. And, you know, I was telling your boys here that anybody that gets involved is going to come out looking very smart and very rich.
Well, first time, we guess that's part of the reason we're here tonight, isn't it?
I think so.
So glad to hear that. But listen, I've got to work the room a little bit. I'll hear a little more about it later, okay?
Absolutely.
Great to meet you, Vic.
We'll talk later.
Okay, guys.
Thanks.
How are you? I'm Dan White.
Thanks so much for coming tonight. Thank you for your support.
These people are fucking unbelievable. I'm telling you.
Hey, Bobby, what do you call this food? I don't even know what it is.
This thing is finger food.
So you're enjoying the food. It's good, isn't it? Nice to meet you. I love your dress. It's beautiful. It's Jim. Hi, how are you? Good to meet you. Nice to meet you, Dan White.
There it is.
What?
Don't you see it?
What?
That guy I introduced you to downstairs is a real estate developer. He is a big deal. He's going to build another Fisherman's Wharf right here, only bigger. Pier 39, he's going to call it. And he's offering us a piece of it.
He's giving it to us?
Well, no. We have to come up with $20,000 for the lease. But he says that once it's up and running, we could clear about $90,000 a year.
$90,000? Danny, where are we going to borrow that?
Well, this party will raise $5,000, and Ray will go in with us, and I can talk to my brother.
What about your seat on the board?
I'll keep that. All the supervisors supplement their income, Mary, and don't think they don't.
Do you think these people are honest?
Mary Ann, these people are changing San Francisco for the better. I want us to be a part of that. They need someone to speak for them.
Aye.
So noted. Let the minutes show that the permits for Pier 39 have been approved. Mr. Borman?
Pier 39 is not a social issue, Harvey. It's about growth.
Oh, really? Who benefits?
Yeah, there are jobs involved. The place is going to need janitors, waiters, maintenance people.
Just the kind of opportunity a human would slit a wrist for.
Gentlemen, if you don't mind.
I'll tell you who benefits. The developers.
He's risking his capital, isn't he?
Capital? Oh, this is like sacred, like the five books of Moses.
End of discussion. Mr. Borman, would you call the next question, please?
Yes, Madam Chairman. The next question on the agenda is...
Okay, that's it. What do you think?
I like it.
Think we got a moneymaker.
Sure helps to help people.
Looks good.
You really think so? We're in business.
Yeah.
crew of the Drop Pilot Club to have breakfast. Need a couple of heavy hitters.
Anytime.
They're asking how the board will vote on it, the real estate transfer thing.
Yeah, the city's got to generate revenue, pay the law enforcement and so forth.
By jamming a tax on the sale of real estate. It worries us, frankly.
I told George I'd vote for it.
Yeah? Who's going to know?
It'll be in the record.
Dan, I'm me. I'm just your friend, okay? But when I speak to you, I speak for the, say, 200 people who really know. People who really run the city. I'm a window. You want to look through me. Climb through the window while it's open. Look around. Join those people and tell me if you see George Moscone anywhere.
People change their minds, but even those that don't have a lot of political morals at least would call the mayor and say, you know I told you I was going to vote for you on this thing, but I've changed my mind. He just blindsided Moscone on that.
All right, here comes trouble. Here comes trouble.
Moscone, you can hit the real man today. Yes,
thank you. Thank you.
Hi. Thanks. Things lightened up a little?
All right, please. Get in there, right?
Taking out a lot of loans. But we know we have friends. And Danny's a lot more optimistic now. No, he's a fighter. And of course he has you.
Back, moving back. All right, Denise. Stay in there, right? Come to Daddy. Come to Daddy.
See?
No. You saw it, too. You call it. Good call.
Oh, come on. He was out.
What is wrong with you people? He was out by a mile.
Dan, come on.
Dan, he was wait, out.
Dan, come on. It's just a... Dan. I go to the mayor.
Who's out?
Come on, it's just a game. Bam.
Dan? Sorry to bother you, but you have some calls from the constituents?
I'll get through it later.
You're gonna have to call them sooner or later. It's been weeks.
Yeah, I'll get to it. Molinari?
Aye.
Pelosi?
Oh.
Silver?
Aye.
White?
Opposed.
So noted. The record will show that the real estate transfer tax has been rejected by the board. Next question, Mr. Borman.
Well, that's beautiful. And where will we get the money to keep the city afloat? Your checkbook?
Oh, do I detect a hint of sour grapes, Supervisor Milk? Mr. Borman, next order of business.
Thank you very much. Come back to see us again.
Can you understand what it was like to see your wife behind a deep fryer slaving away, not knowing if you make enough money to support your family? With all the uncertainty and trying to do a good job for the city, the people. I don't think that anybody realizes.
I hear the city blew up Moscone's tax proposal. What I don't get, Danny, is why you didn't vote for it.
Looking good for business.
Oh, come on, big money in me? Who's the city gonna tax anyway? Working stiffs like you and me, guys who go paycheck to paycheck?
It's not that simple, Bobby.
All right, I'll make it simple for you, Danny. If the city goes broke, how am I going to get paid, huh? Come on, don't be an asshole. People are starting to talk out in the valley. You know, a lot of people who busted their ass to get you elected.
You want my job? You see your wife cutting up potatoes all day? Huh? So what are you worried about?
Thank you.
What do you want?
It's Denise.
I want to talk to her.
I really think you should. The district is trying to recall you.
When we elected him, he said that he would represent this district. Has he? No, he has not. His voting record shows that he represents the power and the money on the other side of town. I mean, have you seen him? Where is he? Where is Dan White? Who is Dan White?
I'm right here. You don't know anything. You don't know anything. I work hard. My wife works hard. There is not a person in this room that works harder than I do.
For who?
Who said that? Huh? You come up here and you ask me that to my face. I am the man that you elected. I am telling you to go home. There's only one thing wrong in this district, and that's the troublemakers in this room. And I know who they are. I know every last one of them. And they're snakes.
On Halloween, you want to block off Polk Street?
Well, it's a tradition, Dan.
So we can have another gay parade? We have had enough.
Says who?
Me.
Are you acting on your own?
Harvey, I am a former police officer. Don't forget that. You close off that street, you're going to see a traffic jam that the force cannot handle.
So you're saying the force won't be with us?
See, that is part of the problem here. It's all a big joke. At their gay day parade, you remember that? They had a 6-foot penis on one of their floats. Well, that's really funny, right? That man had no respect.
I have nothing but respect for people who put their lives on the line for the rest of us. All the rest of us.
Oh, come on.
Dan, they close off the streets for the Italians, they close off the streets for the Chinese, and we have St. Patrick's Day.
Now, that is different.
Why is it different? Why? Why, Dan? You have nothing to say because your argument's illogical, because it's biased, it is bigoted, and that's too bad.
This has got to be stopped. Am I the only one that can see what's happening out there? Am I the only one that cares? Am I just a lonely voice in the wilderness?
Hey, Danny, can we out you in private?
Yeah, sure. Come on over here.
Danny, you couldn't, we have to hear about it on the fucking news. I mean, what message that send your friends? You don't think you owe Vic and me anything?
I owe the bank. You want to know how much?
We'll float you a low-interest loan.
Look, you reacted emotionally. I mean, who we got on the board if you're not there to keep those fucks in line? Now, you go see Moscone, and you tell him to give you the job back.
I'm not going to ask him for anything.
Well, then what? Because if you think the fire department or the police or any dipshit corner store in District 8 is going to give you a job, forget it. You know what's sad, Danny? Your father broke his ass for 30 years as a fireman so you could have a shot at something better than him. Yeah, you know? I'm glad Big Charlie isn't here to see this. So think about it. Think about it real hard.
Getting a lot of calls from supporters in District 8, and they keep calling and wondering...
Shut up, Denise. You just think about it, because you got to live with it. I don't want to talk about it anymore, Ray.
Oh, fine. If this is what you want to do, then it's done. You just throw in the fucking towel.
What do you want me to do, Ray? You want me to fucking call him? I will fucking call him!
Sir, hi, it's Dan White. I'm fine. Hey, is George still in?
Thanks. Good girl, Sear. George, hey, it's Dan White.
I asked the mayor's office to return my letter, and they did. I intend to keep working as I always have for the city and for the people of District 8. Thank you very much.
Dan, you're making it hard on yourself.
I went down to see the city attorney, Bill Toomey. You were on the phone with him. What was that all about?
I know that George sort of reappointed you. Dan, you resigned. The clerk, I think, has already filed a copy of your letter in the record. I mean, really. I wouldn't get your hopes up.
You'd love to see a gay person take my seat on the board, wouldn't you?
It wouldn't be the end of the world.
Reverend Jim Jones, also known as James Warren Jones, was a charismatic spiritual...
The city attorney's going to check the charter. See if it allows me to rescind my resignation.
And if it doesn't?
I gotta go see George. Talk to him in person.
Officials in Guyana wanted the world to see the result of one of the largest mass suicides in history.
I know I gave you back your letter, Dan, but as far as the job is concerned, it's not going to be that simple.
That's all politics, George.
Bylaws, actually. We'll know more in a couple of days.
And what if it comes up no?
In that case, the appointment or your reappointment will devolve upon me.
It's always you, George. What am I supposed to tell my district? My family? My...
Your backers? Dan, there's no shame in telling the truth.
Well, then you can damn well reappoint me.
You represent a swing vote in an otherwise divided board. You promised me your vote on the real estate transfer tax. You gave me your word, remember? And you broke it. All you do is cut up the pie so your friends get the pieces. What are you, the Messiah? Or is that just politics, too?
I'm not going to argue words with you, George.
They're moral precepts, Dan.
You'll call me. Let me know.
Dan.
And he really didn't want to be reappointed to the Board of Supervisors. He was caving in to the pressure that he was feeling from his friends in the police department and the power brokers downtown, who knew that when he left the board and George Moscone appointed his successor, that George was going to have the majority votes on the board.
I'm still committed to completing my term as supervisor.
We are filing a restraining order, which I understand Judge Mayer will hear on Friday afternoon.
Thank you very much.
Well, that's that. You just don't get it, do you, Dan?
No, he doesn't.
Stupid.
He turned us down.
Judges, they're all the same.
Your name's still on Moscone's list. We'll see what happens Monday, huh?
And he said he'd call you, right? He's got to keep his word.
You're right. He'll call me. Good to see you. Thanks for coming down.
Take care, Daddy.
To go to Alaska. He returned the next year and left again in 1973 to become a fireman. He began his police duties at the Northern Station. John?
Thanks, Judy. The following week, the supervisor said he was resigning because he could not support himself on his city salary. At the time, Mayor Moscone talked about a replacement.
I'll await Judge Mayer's ruling, and then the following Monday, which is the 27th, I'll announce the decision.
Anyone in line for the mayor?
Yes, there is an alternate list, and all of them are from District 8.
What about Dan White?
All I'm going to say is that former Supervisor White's name is one of the names on that list, all right?
Where did you reload?
I reloaded in my office.
happen if you left there, Dan?
I left the mayor's office by one of the back doors, and I was going to go down the stairs, and then I saw Harvey Milk. I said, yeah, I'll just go talk to him. And I didn't agree with him on a lot of things, but I was always honest, and where they were devious. And he just kind of smirked at me, you know, because he knew. He knew I was going to be reappointed. And I was telling him how hard I'd worked for it and what it meant to me and my family and my reputation being a hard-working, honest, decent person. And he just kind of smirked at me as if to say, too bad. And then I just got all hot, flushed, and I shot him.
I'm in here.
There you go. There we go.
That was work.
A little slow.
I'm gonna get back pretty soon.
Maybe he's hungry.
He ate. Did Thomas show up?
Yeah, he came by this afternoon.
What about you? Did you eat?
Yeah. I'm fine. Hello?
Dan White, please.
Speaking.
This is Barbara Taylor of CBS News. Have you heard from the mayor about the appointment tomorrow?
No one.
Danny, talk to me. Don't you think you should talk to someone? A doctor, maybe?
Milk, Friday, November 18th.
Hello?
I'm calling from your office.
We were all outside. The supporters and the press. And George just went out of his way to scoot around us. Then I went to his office. Those bastards, they were in there laughing and joking.
Denise, don't worry about it. I'm still really confident about the appeal.
Okay.
Just take it easy. I'll see you later.
Bye.
pick me up.
Afterwards and tell me what the mayor says.
Okay. Maybe we can meet Marianne and have some lunch. Side door never showed up. I had to get in.
Yeah, and you are?
Dan White. City supervisor. Say, I gotta go.
Go on in. He'll see you now.
Good girl's here.
I heard that you're not gonna give it back to me. My job. Is that true?
Yes, it is, Dan. And it's nothing personal. Dan, this is all about politics, and you can understand that.
You told me you would call me. You said you would call me. You gave me your word.
Dan, we're grown-ups here. Now, you had your chance.
Hey, it was your choice, remember? And I had to make my choice.
Please sit down.
Why would you choose someone else? Jesus. Don't you care what happens to my family?
Oh, sure I do. You know I do. Come on inside. Let's have a drink. Dan, you're gonna land on your feet. I know it.
You didn't even have the decency to tell me.
And you had the decency to tell me about your restraining order?
I want my job back, George.
Dan, I know you're upset. The bottom line is that it's done. It's over. And I think the best thing you could do is focus on your family.
Wait a minute, Diane. Harvey? Can I see you for a minute?
Sure.
happy now?
As Oscar Werner said in Ship of Fools, who's happy?
Give me your keys.
Supervisors, it is my duty to make this announcement. Both Mayor Moscone and Supervisor Harvey Milk have been shot and killed. The suspect is Supervisor Dan White. Nothing more.
That's all for now. Thank you.
I've always been a hardworking, honest person. I never cheated anybody. I just wanted to do a good job. And I've seen the city kind of going downhill. And I was just a lonely vote on the board. I just wanted to do a good job for the city. I was just trying to do a good job for the city.
The march started at 17th and Castro Street, the heart of Harvey Milk's district. Thousands of people, almost all of them holding small candles. A spontaneous march formed just a few hours after the assassination of Harvey Milk and George Moscone. It may be the single greatest outpouring of grief since the death of Martin Luther King. Thank you.
had a fear that something like that would happen. And I think the fear was based on many personal experiences that we all had as fags and dykes of getting taunted in school. You know, I found ways home that were different every day from my school. And the shame that you felt, but really the physical danger that you felt, because it was a life-death issue. People did get killed, and there was no one to go to. As I mentioned before, you went to the cops, they arrested you. You went to the psychiatrist, he committed you. You went to the doctor, you know, he gave you some drugs and told you, you know, to get over it. You went to religion, they said you're going to go to hell, become a priest, whatever. And so the idea that some harm might come to a Harvey, it wasn't foreign to a lot of people.
Dad is so quiet these days. About you. Yes. What's it? The DA is going to ask for the death penalty. You have to be at the trial. We all do.
So they can leer at us like we're all monsters. The threats, the calls, they're all ours. I'm sick of it.
It's very important for the jury to see us. All of us.
I can't.
You have to. For your grandson.
Under a doctor's care. Are you under any medication at all?
No. Do you have anything to add before we close this?
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Just that I've always been a hard-working, honest person. I never cheated anybody. I just wanted to do a good job. And I was seeing the city kind of going downhill, and I was just a lonely vote on the board. I just wanted to do a good job for the city. I was just trying to do a good job for the city.
Members of the jury, what counsel for the defense has done is to suggest that you excuse this kind of conduct and call it something that it isn't. Now, you are triers of fact here. Now, you've been asked to listen to this tape recording. It's been described as something very moving. Now, we all have a sense of sympathy, for our fellow man. But you are not to let sympathy interfere with your judgment.
Inspector Falzone, you mentioned that you had known Dan White in the past.
Yes, sir, quite well.
Can you tell me when you saw him first on November 27th, 1978? How did he appear physically to you?
Destroyed. This was not the Dan White I'd known then at all. That day I saw a shattered individual, both mentally and physically. Dan White, the man I'd known prior to Monday, the 27th of November, 1978, was a man among men.
When you picked him up, was there anything unusual?
Well, he wouldn't look at me. He was very nervous. He was a different man. Somebody I'd never seen before. It was scary. He squinted hard and he kept rubbing his hands together. He just seemed very agitated. Acting very hurt. Frightened me.
In the car, when you were driving, was there some discussion relative to a statement you made, quote, anger had run pretty high all week towards the mayor playing pool on us, dirty, you know, unquote?
Yes.
Ms. Apcar, when you were driving Dan White to City Hall, did you know he was carrying a loaded gun?
No, no, I did not.
I work with Danny, so I got to know him well. This is a man who rescued a woman and child from a burning building. He was an excellent fireman.
Dan was my friend. I got to know his family pretty well. And when we were at the academy together, he was an inspiration to all of us. He was valedictorian of the fire department class.
What galled me most was the picture of Dan White as the all-American boy. Maybe as a gay man, I understand the tyranny of the all-American boy. Because so often, I am his victim.
I think he had the capacity to do something for a base and antisocial purpose. I think he had the capacity to know that there was a duty imposed upon him not to do that. But I don't think he had the capacity to keep that notion in mind while he was acting. There's a substantial body of evidence that in susceptible individuals, large quantities of what we call junk foods can precipitate antisocial and even violent behavior. Whenever he felt things were not going right, he would abandon his usual exercise and good nutrition and start gorging himself on junk foods. Twinkies, Coca-Cola. Soon, Mr. White was just sitting in front of the TV. He couldn't sleep. He was confused, had crying spells, became increasingly ill, and wanted to be left alone. He told me that he always felt like the black sheep of the family, the odd man out. He said they're always putting him down.
I met him in April 1976.
You were married, and you took a trip.
Yes. Yes, we went to Ireland on our honeymoon. He really likes, he loves everything about Ireland, and so we went there for about 5 weeks.
And during this period, did you notice anything unusual about his behavior?
Yes. I mean, you know, when we went, I went thinking, I thought it was going to be kind of romantic, and when we got there, it was all of a sudden, he went into like a two-week-long mood, like I had seen before when we were going out, but I had never seen one, I guess, all the way through. I was just newly married, and I thought, oh, what did I do?
And after he was on the board, did you notice these moods became more frequent?
Yes. He had told me about how hard the job was on him. I mean, from June, he had started talking about how it was.
Are you okay? Take your time. It's okay.
Obviously, you can sense when you're not sleeping together and you're not really growing together. And he would say, well, I can't really think of anyone else when I don't even like myself. But I said, well, he just isn't satisfied with what I'm doing, and I don't really like myself, so I can't. The thing that attracted me most to Danny was his vitality, his energy, and the fact that he always had the ability to inspire something that made you want to do your best, like he did.
And did you see him on the morning of the 27th?
Yes, I did.
And at that time, did he indicate to you what he was going to do that day?
He was going to stay home. He wasn't leaving the house.
And later that morning, did you receive a phone call to meet him somewhere?
Yes, I did. I went to St. Mary's Cathedral. I saw him there, and I could see he had been crying. And I just sort of looked at him, and he just looked at me, and he said, I shot the mayor and Harvey.
I have nothing further. Thank you.
Cycle of brutality and murder, and there are those here who said that we must somehow learn to love and understand and forgive the sins that have been committed against us. Please, honey.
Checkmate.
Denny. Jerry Foreman called the judge. They're coming in.
Thanks, Jerry.
The jury reached verdicts in this case?
Yes, it has, Your Honor.
Will the defendant please rise?
Please read the verdicts.
The jury finds the defendant, Daniel James White, guilty of violating section 192.1 of the Penal Code, voluntary manslaughter for the slain of Mayor George Moscone. The jury finds the defendant, Daniel James White, guilty of violating section 192.1 of the Penal Code, voluntary manslaughter in the slain of Supervisor Harvey Milton.
Unbelievable. He'll be out in 5 years.
Outside City Hall.
What for?
A lot of people are unhappy with the verdicts. They don't think it was just. They're angry.
I don't know that we'll ever understand what went on in the heads of the jurors in the Dan White case. They certainly didn't represent the cross-section of San Franciscans, and Obviously, there are those who think the district attorney just blew the case. It seemed like such a simple barroom murder. There was all the evidence. There was a gun. He snuck in a window. He had motive. And there are those who think that the trial just turned into a trial about Dan White and his politics. You know, there were no members of the families, the victims' families who were there. Everybody was busy grieving and trying to pull the city back together again. So I just don't know that we'll ever know. It was just a complete aberration. I guess justice was eventually served, but not in that courtroom.
Here, at least, Dan White was safe for the past few years. He was given special protection. But once outside, he'll be in danger, according to prison officials. They fear revenge by someone from the gay community in San Francisco, so Dan White will be released secretly tomorrow.
The countdown is almost over now, and tomorrow, Dan White will be free. He may be free from prison, but as Mayor Feinstein said, he will never be free from the memory of what he did here, November 27, 1978.
McHugh!
Yeah, here.
John?
Hey, Jesus, how you doing?
Staying in shape, how about you?
What's this name they got down here for you, McHugh?
Bard. Makes things easier, you know, the way things go. So I heard you were working down here. Moonlight, huh?
Oh, yeah. Well, you know how tough it is to make ends meet.
Oh, yeah. So how long you been doing this?
About a year and a half. I know these guys pretty good. I used to do concerts for them at Candlestick.
Oh, yeah, huh?
How are the kids here? You got three now, right?
Yeah. Yeah, Rory. He's got the Down syndrome, you know? He's a sweet kid, though. Just love him. He's so sweet. So, gonna put me on the job?
If it was up to me, Danny, I'd give you half the city now that it's back on track. I'm proud of you, Danny, you know that. But I don't make the rules. You know, we need somebody who's bonded, all right? Let's face it, you've done time. You should talk to the hotels. They're always looking for day help. You know, people who can at least speak English.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, you'll find something.
Hey, it's good to see you, John. I've been thinking about something.
Would you put Rory in the playpen? I gotta go to work.
Yeah. Well, I was thinking maybe we should just... Here, let me take this for 1 second. You know, we should just move. You know, like to Alaska. I mean, everyone up there, well, most people
Charlie,
up there have a history and...
Would you go and see what Rory's doing in the playpen, honey? Thank you.
It really frosted me, you know, Diane. Well, she sends her new chief to have this little talk with me before I was even paroled. You know, her honor. Thinks the city would appreciate it if you lived someplace else for a while. I mean, I thought she was a friend. And now, after all this time, not even a phone call, she, of all people, should understand what I've been through, how hard I've worked. I mean, you work too.
Thank you. Will things be any different in Alaska, Dan? Do we have any friends there? Do we have any family in Alaska?
It was just an idea, you know? Like, a way we could start over.
What? Over? I feel like I've started over every day since... I don't know when. But maybe there's something wrong with me. Is there? Tell me! Does anything ever change? I mean, have the bills gone away? Has the past? Will it ever? This is who we are! This is how life is. Our life. There isn't any starting over.
Harvey Milk, Friday, November 18th. This tape is only to be played in the event of my death by assassination. I'm fully aware that anybody who stands for what I stand for, an activist, a gay activist, becomes the target or the potential target of someone who's insecure or terrified, afraid, very disturbed in themselves. And knowing that I could be assassinated at any minute, any time, it's important for me that some people know what it was I was thinking about. I stood for more than being a candidate. I mean, I never considered myself a candidate. I always considered myself part of a movement, part of a candidacy. I wish I had time to let people know what I was thinking. But nearly everything I've done has been in the eyes of the gay movement. If someday a bullet enters my brain, let it destroy every closet door.
Death in and of itself. I mean, I think people felt a certain sense of closure. I don't think people necessarily felt reward in it. But it did happen 8 years after the murders, and so there was some distance in terms of the visceral reaction. There's no guarantee that Harvey Milk or what happened to Harvey Milk is going to be in the lexicon, you know, 10 years from now. But certainly, as long as you got people from that generation and people interested in history and civil rights yet, I think that his legacy will be around.
George Moscone was the heart and soul of the liberal movement in San Francisco. I mean, George was joy.
These were two people that were real, that loved life and loved people and loved being a part of life. And whether they've been in politics or not, we just can't afford to lose people like that. And it's just it's a real tragedy that, in a way, I guess we'll never get over it.